I'm really pleased to introduce our speaker. I took his bias test, and Matthew, I must say I scored 70 for bias towards people like me, which means 411, used to teach, Chicago, deep dish pizza, and can't swim. I'm in trouble. So I can't wait to hear what you're going to say, because Matthew Cahill has built a consulting and coaching practice based on the belief that if you have a brain, you have bias. Obviously, I have a brain and lots of bias. He joins us from Silicon Valley area. And what he is a consultant who excels at meeting people where they are and organizations where they are, and then takes them from bias to something that I think is the most important aspect of what we all really need and want, and that is belonging. We all want to feel that we're part of something. And so we're fortunate to spend some time with him to learn how bias is not only impacting our bottom line, but also our personal lives. So please join me in welcoming someone who I talked to him, has a great sense of humor and is so well-versed in his subject, our very nice speaker, Matthew Cahill. Yay, Matthew.
Wow. Will you come with me on the road? I want you to do every introduction that I ever have from this point forward.
At your service.
Lovely, Susan. Thank you. And you teed this up very well. I do love the introductions. I love the energy. I love the camaraderie. I love the spirit in this room. It's very, very warm and welcoming. You know, the jokes, you know, they're in my mind, I categorize them as dad jokes, which I have a 12-year-old and a 15-year-old. And I have grown to just love that moment of delivering, you know, a finely tuned dad joke. And I'm the only one cracking up, but you know, the eyes are rolling and you know, the heads are nodding and they, you know, quickly vacate the room. But I love that. I love that humor. And that's what it reminded me of with a lot of the jokes that were being passed around this morning. So thank you. I am going to hijack your screens just for a moment because I did prepare some things that I want to use to help illustrate some of the key messages that I want to get across today. So if I do that, can you confirm for me that you can see this beautiful splash page?
Yes, and it's up.
It says, somebody read that for me. What does it say?
You have a brain, you have bias.
Yes, I built a business on that belief. So much so that it is actually trademarked with the United States Patent Office. And it's finally a way to use language to open up deeper conversations. And that's what I found bias to be. So if you'll indulge me, I'd like to just pick your brains a little bit. Using the chat, just type in what you are walking into this meeting understanding as the definition of bias. What does it mean? And you're welcome to take yourself off mute and just shout it out if you want to do that. The risk you might shout over somebody else. But I find the chat to be a very easy way to put that in there. Although, you know, some of us are not as easy to click on the buttons and the mechanics involved with chatting. I did see some people chatting in here. So it seemed like a very chat-friendly audience. Aha! Thank you, Janice. Janice Litvin, Banish Burnout. She says, preconceived notions about a group, people, or subject. Yes, bias extends beyond people to places and things. Absolutely. Tim Durkin is saying a preconception that you are correct. Absolutely. That's a type of bias. I like to lump that under confirmation bias. Claudette, audience attitude based on your belief that filters what you experience. Yes. Deep-seated preferences. Yes. Is it seated or seated? Deep-seated preferences. Bill, either way, I think the point is biases run very deep. Now, Susan just threw a last definition there called stereotypical thoughts of others. All of this, all of these are part of the definition of bias, the broader definition of bias. But bias is something that's very unique in that it has different meanings depending on the context, right? So bias is often used in relation to something called gender bias, racial bias, cultural bias, bias related to age. Now, each one of these types of bias, and this list goes on and on and on, fall under a broader category of what I call social biases. And social biases also include orientation, lifestyle, class, region, where you live. They're those types of identity-related biases fall under a category of social bias because they're best measured by behaviors and actions, not necessarily thoughts. And I want to focus today a little bit more on our brains. In some of the introductions, I think this will be a very synergistic presentation for you because in some of the introductions, I was hearing people talking about uncovering some of the hidden influences of why we do what we do. And it really does stem from that muscle between our ears. And that muscle between our ears, our brains, can be oversimplified into two basic functions, right? Consciousness and unconsciousness. And these are philosophical concepts, right? A consciousness, some would wonder if it even exists. In this context, I want to be clear that when I refer to a conscious bias, I'm referring more towards those visible and identifiable actions, right? And that action could just be stating some hate speech or something like that, right? But there's a wide spectrum on conscious bias. The key characteristic there, it's readily identifiable by large numbers of people. It's easy to spot conscious bias. Unconscious bias is a little trickier because unconscious bias is a byproduct of the way our brains process information in any given moment of any given day. Our brains are processing about 11 million bits of information. 11 million bits of information are being processed by our brain unconsciously, all under the proverbial hood. Our conscious mind is capable of processing about 50 bits of information. But it's through that 50-bit window that we determine and perceive what we call real, what we call truth. Now, just look at the statistical difference here. Our unconscious mind is constantly churning and chugging and processing information to the tune of 99.96% of all inputs and income. It's regulating our body temperature. Our unconscious mind is pumping blood through our veins. Our unconscious mind is constantly on alert to see if there's any threats around us. Our unconscious mind is what's triggered if something does happen to enter our sphere. And before we can consciously process what it is, we react, right? And we either duck or move or do. Our unconscious mind is constantly being activated. And I would argue that our unconscious mind is actually shaping more of what our 50-bit area is even capable of focusing on. So when we think about how we gain some insights into this relatively new model, there are some very renowned thinkers. One of them that I draw upon a great deal is Daniel Kahneman. If you haven't read his book, Thinking Fast and Slow, highly recommend it. Again, it's an oversimplification of how our brains process information, but it's very useful in understanding how bias is born out of our thoughts and out of a way our thoughts are constructed and created. And so what he's done is categorize conscious or unconscious mental processing has these characteristics, right? It's fast, it's automatic, it's how we make our everyday choices. But the byproduct there is that it's also very error prone. System two is that conscious area of mental processing where we really have to apply focus. We really have to pay attention. It's built into the language. And I can see in gallery view, some of you are succumbing to that temptation, right? There's something else that's just distracting. We're not willing to, it grabs our attention. And this is one of the conundrums of our time today. We are so inundated with information, it's become very difficult to be mentally disciplined in the system two area and just be willing to pay attention. So why do we do this? Why do we get into this area? For me, it's very fascinating. I'm genuinely curious to understand and deepen my understanding about how my brain shapes my reality. And in the last 10 to 15 years, there's been tremendous advances in neuroscience, in evolutionary psychology, in biology that shine some light on how our brains are wired for bias. There's now over 200 actual named cognitive bias with accompanying research to showcase these little, what I like to call quirks of cognition. And what I'd like to do right now is show you one of the tools that I've created to shine some light on these different quirks of cognition. And so what I'm going to do is teach you something about this wonderful Zoom universe that we've been living in, that y'all have been living in for the last, I don't know how long you've been doing these meetings, but you do these every week. This is one of the coolest tools in Zoom, and it allows all of us to do some things together at one time. So what I'm going to do is walk you through the steps for this. So get your keyboards ready, get your hands on your keyboard or your mouse actually is what you need, and mouse over the Zoom window. And you should see a little screen, a little green bar at the top of the Zoom window that says view options. Select view options, and then you'll get a pop-up. And one of those options should be annotate. And I'm going out on a limb here to say this was a default setting because a Zoom admin has to set it up and this isn't my Zoom account. Can you confirm for me, somebody tell me, is annotate there?
No, we do not. Well, yep. We do not have annotate on ours. Sorry.
Let me see if I can do this for you then. Let's see.
That did not allow that in our settings. So.
Oh my gosh. That setting is one of the most unique things about Zoom. It's very dangerous because you get people come in there and start to scribble on things. But I welcome that kind of interactivity. I welcome that kind of behavior. So please do bear with me. We do have the chat to use. So what I will do is I'm going to put into the chat the link to that same assessment that Susan spoke about earlier today. So that's going to be in the chat. My dog is very upset that he can't witness the annotate. That's too bad. He likes to join in periodically. The link that I just put in the chat will allow you to take a closer look at these questions. The questions are designed to shine some light on the five most common cognitive biases. And I want to give this message loud and clear, especially to Susan. Because what I heard is that she's thinking bias, like that score of 70% of like me bias. There's absolutely nothing wrong, right? Our brains are wired to produce bias, period. And we're finding more and more and more and more different ways that our brains have these cognitive quirks. So please do not fear that test, embrace it. Take a look at it and accept it for what it is. Every assessment in the world, Myers-Briggs, personality, communication tests, all of them are a mere snapshot in time. They only have as much meaning as you give to them, and the same is true with my assessment. My assessment has been designed to give you some indication as to what these different five types of cognitive biases are. They form an acronym called LEAP. So what I like to start with is the one that Susan pointed out, like me bias. This is our natural tendency to gravitate towards people who are like us. It stems from a survival heuristic deep down into the more primitive parts of our brain, our reflective brain, our reflexive brain, which is constantly scanning the world around us for threats, right? And so all the time you're making judgments on people, places, and things and putting people in an in-group or an out-group. And that's just an automatic process. And so what happens over time is that we tend to start to overvalue certain people, places, and things that are like us, right? And that's how we end up in more homogenous communities, which in and of itself isn't necessarily a bad thing. But once you start to see how that pattern over time really does need to be disrupted in order to have those enriching experiences that were described by, was describing like the keys to happiness, right? We need to disrupt these kind of entrenched patterns. If we don't disrupt them over time, it's often shown that they can lead to routines, can lead to ruts. Ruts can lead to just unbreakable patterns of behavior that can sometimes lead towards episodes of depression, of just stagnation, right? They can lead to things that are unintended outcomes. And so each one of these biases, egocentric bias, availability bias, anchoring bias, proximity bias, I could do a full, day-long presentation on any one of them. But each one of them, these are the five that I found are the most common of the over 200 cognitive biases. And they each play a role in establishing what I call the bias ecosystem. Now, you remember at the beginning of this presentation, I differentiated between cognitive biases and social biases, and you're seeing them now in this conceptual model. And I want to, take a moment to just really elaborate and allow this conceptual model to sink in, because this is illustrating what I had described earlier about bias being born in our brains as a byproduct of how our brains process information. From there, it moves into our behaviors and actions, which is how it manifests itself into our relationships, into the world at large. Underneath these, and it morphs, when you hear it in the language, into social biases. Again, social biases are best measured by behaviors and actions. And it's those behaviors and actions over time is how bias becomes institutionalized in our respective workplaces and in the greater society at large. And so when you start to pick apart, my niche is working with businesses to help them understand how bias has become baked into their hiring processes, their promotion processes, who gets a seat at the table, where power resides within an organization. All of these are areas that bias has become baked into our various institutions. And once it's there, this is how the cycle perpetuates itself. Now we have new people coming in, they learn about these biases, they get these biases, accept these biases as being normal and a part of just the way things are done. And this is how the bias ecosystem perpetuates itself. So what I'd like to do is just pause there for a moment. I'm gonna stop screen sharing. And I don't know if your protocol is to continue recording. I'm happy to have questions recorded, and then I'll give you my responses as recorded. But if that makes anybody feel a little, like they don't want to share, put the question in the chat. I would love to field it there. Whatever your protocol is, I'm happy to follow. I'm not seeing anything in the chat. Is there anyone that's willing to come off mute with any even reaction or question? I would love to
start
you here. Go ahead, Tony.
I took the quiz or the survey, I should say. I don't know if it's a quiz, but and I came out as 65% egocentric, I believe. What does that mean, and how is that, if that's bad, can it be changed?
Love it. Love it, love it, love it. Egocentric bias is very common with doctors, with attorneys, with any subject matter expert. So think of engineers, people who have spent a large amount of time in one area and developed a level of expertise. And when they develop that level of expertise, what happens over time is they forget that not everybody else has that same level of expertise. And so the executives that I coach, often very, a common practice to forget that not everybody in the company lives and breathes their world. And so egocentric bias is overvaluing our own experience, right? It's not necessarily a bad thing. You would never be able to achieve high levels of success in different disciplines if you don't have a measure of egocentric bias. But where it becomes counterproductive is usually when we're not paying attention to it, right? And all of a sudden you're throwing down acronyms as if everybody knows what they mean. And you got just these like deer in the headlight blank stares. I have no idea. And so the mitigation practice is to really, have to pause, to listen more, talk less, really value those other perspectives to get yourself out of that mindset of this is the only way that we can do things. So that's one of the many mitigation strategies that are involved with egocentric bias. But I hope that shines some light on that for you.
Janet, question? She raised her hand.
Yes, thank you. First of all, Matthew, I'm so excited to see you speak today. For those who don't know, Matthew, tell them about the ILVW. Matthew runs a group on Wednesdays at 10 that I've been attending lately and will be facilitating a week from today. But that's not why I raised my hand. So there's so much depth to what you shared in a few short slides. It's overwhelming to me that you inferred that we're born with certain preconceived biases, or were you saying that we're brought up with certain, or both? And from there, what do we do about it, especially in a grouping like a workplace?
Wow. So the short answer is I don't know that we're born, I guess.
Well, you inferred that there's a reptilian element to our bias.
Yeah. I'm just trying to think. I've never really thought through the idea that, your genetic makeup probably has biases born into it, right? Like the color of your skin, your eye color, your hair color, mm-hmm. all of those things are predetermined before you're conscious, right? And so those are already shaping how you're going to experience the world. So absolutely, bias is part of our DNA. Now, what do we do about it in the workplace? I think the bias ecosystem, that model is the most effective model that I've found to unpack and pinpoint bias that's causing problems. Mm-hmm. And when you're able to accurately identify the type of bias that's causing problems in the workplace, the beauty of the workplace is that it's a contained unit. It's like its own petri dish. It's its own entity. And you get to write the rules of how you're going to be able to have people treat each other, right? How you govern what you do and how you do it. Now, it's not impervious to the greater societal context, right? I think workplaces all inherit the biases that exist in the wider society. You can't isolate yourself from that. So I think that the ecosystem is a great way to get more precise in what it is that we're talking about and then what we can do about it. Go ahead, Colin.
Unmute here. So I took the little test and I think the highest I scored was availability. That was the highest bias I scored.
Beautiful. Availability bias is usually the one that people score the highest on. Mm-hmm. Because it's unpacking the idea that we are, because our brains are processing so much information, we create mental shortcuts. And availability bias is born out of expediency, right? If we had to try to consciously process 11 million bits of information every moment, it would be crippling, right? If you had to like consciously issue a command every beat of your heart, I mean, like we're just not designed for that. So availability bias is really born out of the available information that we have. There's permutations of availability bias. I think confirmation bias is one where because we don't want to go through the cognitive effort of really digging in and you know, considering all the different points of view, what we prefer, what our path of least resistance is to just take a preconceived idea and then fill it in with available information that suits our narrative, right? We take tremendous psychological comfort in that. I think that's one of the underlying mental processes that contributes towards polarization, right? Because it's the path of least resistance. So in availability bias, the key to mitigating availability bias is really slowing down once again, considering all of the available information, not just the information that suits your preconceived idea.
Okay. May I ask a question? First of all, as I'm listening to you, I'm sorry, I always think this way, but when you talked about your three types of biases, I thought of that great TV show because it's CSI. So hopefully you can use that at some point. But as I'm listening to you and I'm hearing what you say, there's nature versus nurture. Great question, Janice. That's a really important thing to determine. But I wondered, in listening to you and how we process this, have you worked with the different police forces in the Bay Area?
I have not been fortunate to work with the police force. Some of my colleagues have, and at least in San Francisco and other major metropolitan areas, there are varying degrees of shifts that police officers are being encouraged to embrace. Many of them are rooted in reframing the biases that they're taking out into their job. Now, that's a tall order because there's so many other moving pieces that come into that. But I can say with a degree of certainty that police officers are learning to behave differently. They have to be dialed into their biases. Overall, unfortunately, we all get biased by the headlines that tend to focus on only the times where things go wrong.
Okay. Alan Garber, did you have a question? I thought I saw that you had tried. Okay. Otto Randolph and then Bill Buchanan after.
Good morning. And this is truly a fascinating subject, especially considering what we hear going back and forth in the news and amongst our colleagues, our friends in everyday life. So my question is about bias and media reporting. We hear a lot about, I know people who just won't trust the newspaper because they believe in implicit bias and that it can never be eliminated. So I went to the trouble of looking up various schools of journalism to find out how they handle it. And some of them will mention a 10-step process that journalists are supposed to go through. Pardon the background noise, there's work going on outside my house. They'll mention a 10-step process to help make the reporting as objective as possible. So kind of two questions here. One is it possible with a process to eliminate or at least greatly diminish bias? And the next is, how do we detect it in what we are reading?
Love it, love it, love it, love it, love it. Those are great questions. And Otto, welcome to the new norm of just background noise happening. Like it just happens. I want to make it, first of all, put it into a context. I think there is another type of bias, media bias. And it's very pervasive. It comes out in the television shows that we watch, as well as the news content that we consume. Because remember, we live in a world now that is a 24-hour news cycle, right? It's not like there are three channels and news is 30 minutes at 11 o'clock at night, or you know, one time throughout the day. So the way I frame this is that the bias that's produced by media, and when I say media, I'm talking like all capitals media, social media, CNN, news, internet, I mean, like media, big M, it has a voracious appetite. And so the stories and what matters in every story that's created is just that, not whether or not it's true or false, but just whether or not it can capture your attention, right? Mm-hmm. And if it captures your attention, then it succeeded. And so the system is inherently biased in the content that it produces. And the fact that we're collateral damage is irrelevant, because the system is just feeding itself, right? Like that's the implicit bias that I find when it comes to news and media in general. Does that address your question, Otto? So I think that the best mitigation strategy, given what I just said, is to discipline yourself and not have it on as a background device. Really be selective about the types of sources that you get information from, because we're all subject to our own bubbles, right? We can all fall into, I only, you know, want MSNBC. I hate Fox, right? I would encourage people to actually take a more well-balanced diet, but make it a very limited diet, right? If you can't get what you need out of 30 minutes a day, then there's some other problem happening, right? You're not going to solve all of the problems of the world by just consuming stuff all day long. And that may fly in the face of people who are political junkies or news junkies, or, you know, I would just encourage you to take a look at your addictive behavior.
Can I ask a follow-up to that?
Sure.
I appreciate what you're saying about the attention-grabbing bias of media, so that, you know, everybody wants to make a living. And there are two sources of bias when we're consuming news. It's whatever they're handing us, and however our own bias, you know, tends to make us pay attention. So the question I was trying to ask, really, I think the bottom line is, for sources that at least advertise themselves as attempting toward non-bias, how do we tune ourselves to see if something is bleeding through, whether they intended to or not? For example, some what are considered left-leaning newspapers will do their best to present both sides in, let's say, the gun controversy right now. And it seems to me they're, you know, letting people talk about both sides. But is there a way that I can tune myself to detect what might be a bias?
Otto, I shared this link in the chat, but I feel so passionately about it, I'm gonna just hijack the screen and show it to everybody. Allsides.com is the best source that I've found for vetting out news sources. And there's a rating system in here that's based on a patented technology. The origin story of this site is beautiful. It was a self-described Republican and a self-described Democrat, a self-described conservative and a self-described progressive who came together to create this site. And so it's a tremendous resource for really digging in and seeing the, you know, the characteristics that make up the source of the news that you're consuming. I want to just draw your attention to the power of language right here on this headline. And this updates every day based on whatever event is happening in the world. But if you take a close look at just these headlines from the left, center, and right, you can start to see how the narrative is shaped and where it's going to take you. And it's no wonder, it's not a mystery how we end up in these different, really constructed realities when this is what you're ingesting daily, right? It's taking you into this information world that serves to shape your reality in a certain way. And that is, you know, bias. So I hope that's useful. I hope that that becomes a go-to site for all of you. Otto, did that address your question?
Yes, thank you very much.
Absolutely.
And Alan Garber.
Hi, Michael. I practice labor and employment law, and as such, I do a lot of work in harassment and discrimination cases, and which involve bias and whatever. And in fact, in the legal profession, every 3 years we have to do 25 hours of continuing legal ed. And of that 25 hours, we have to have two or three, I think it is, or one, whatever it is, on bias. My question to you is, what's your opinion of diversity training that is thrust upon people in the workplace and other places? And in particular, what's your opinion on coerced or forced diversity training, and if it works or not? I personally think most of those diversity training programs are BS and don't really do anything, but I'd like to hear your opinion on that.
Oh, thank you, Alan, for just disclosing your own bias. And the language that you used was great too. I mean, thrust upon, forced, to do this. I would say that all of compliance training in the workplace suffers from that same dynamic, right? Being thrust upon, forced, right? Employees have to take anti-discrimination training. They have to take ethics training. They have to take sexual harassment training.
Correct.
And the running joke that I had when I was a full-time employee is, why would I want to learn how to sexually harass somebody? That's easy to do. Like you just do it.
I've conducted those programs myself.
And it's part of the reason why I don't do those. I always say what I do picks up where that leaves off. You are a lawyer and you need to make sure people understand what not to do. And my focus area is more on what to do. I believe that bias and the language of bias matters, because when the moment you start a conversation about prejudice, discrimination, there are legal implications. So what happens to somebody's brain? They go D&D, defensive and denial, right? And that doesn't lead to a constructive outcome. Right? It doesn't lead to strengthening a relationship. And so much of my approach is to use bias, to destigmatize bias, so that we can have an open and honest discussion about where your biases are, where mine are, and chances are they're probably going to overlap with one another. And diversity training is way more than gender, race,
yes, it
culture,
is.
Age. There are so many other dimensions of diversity that get overlooked when you focus on only one. Now, I'm not saying that we should never talk about race. I love conversations about race because they challenge me at my core, right? Because of who I am and how I was born into this world. So, but that's, I had to develop that appetite for that, right? Because I was also born out of a product of education that I think, taught me some instilled ideas about right and wrong and gave me a set of morals in this case, right? But you don't hear it phrased in that language. But I think that's really what's going on is, you're challenging some deep-seated preferences as we defined earlier in the discussion. Alan, did that answer your question?
Well, yes, a bit. I mean, one thing that struck me recently in California dealing with bias or non-bias or whatever was, they passed a law, as you know, or probably know, that required public companies to have women, for example, on their board of directors, which got struck down by the courts as being biased or discriminatory. And so I see what's happening in the last decade or so is we are being forced, and I know you, that's a word that you think, but we're being indoctrinated or whatever to not have a bias, where sometimes biases are good. I mean, it's sometimes okay to hang out with people that are like you. And maybe in the business world, that's true too. You want to be people that are like you. We're seeing the discussion with Twitter and Elon Musk and what's going on with the biases and forcing people to either have a bias or not or whatever. So it's a very complex situation, and I don't have a solution for it, but I think that maybe we're having too much discussion on this stuff, and that's bringing it more to the point where people are getting not together, but separated into little groups.
Mm. Well, I guess I would counter that. I don't, from my perspective, there's not enough conversation that happens. There is a lot of counterproductive conversations and contentious conversations and polarizing conversations. But I think a lot of that is due to treating, you know, conversations on race, gender, any one of those social biases, it's so deeply emotional that the problem arises when you treat it transactionally. And you think like, oh, I can just check this box and it's going to go away. Like, that is so unrealistic if you're talking to somebody in the LGBT community that, you know, has lived their whole life hoping that they could get married one day to a person that they love, right? Like, it's not just about a court document. You know what I mean? Like, it is, but it's so much more to a person. And I think what we lack is really the time it takes to unpack a lot of the emotion that comes along with any one of these topics. That's when they go off the rails, in my experience.
Okay, thank you. Bill Buchanan.
Good morning, Matthew. Thanks very much. I'm never disappointed with our GGBC speakers, you know, being thought provoking, you know, and putting some of those 80 billion to 100 billion brain cells to work.
Yes.
Thank you for that. Anyway, I am a little bit behind the curve because I missed the test. How do I get to the test? Where's the link? Is it on the...
In the chat at 8:17 a.m. If you scroll in the chat, you'll see the link to it there.
8:17. Okay, I'll take care of that. My question... Well, I'm sorry, go ahead. My question goes back to one of the first slides. Well, it had to do with, I guess, with the definition of bias. And there were two columns. The first one on the left was, you know, had a whole bunch of characteristics of certain bias. And I thought it said that this type of bias is usually negative. Do you still have that slide? I think I missed something there because, you know, like...
No, I'll bring
it up. Alan said, you know, not all biases are negative. Like, you know, a bias against bad drivers, for instance, you know, or people who do crimes, you know, stuff like that. There we go. System one. Oh, yeah. Wait a minute. Is that it? Yeah, I'm not sure that's it. Fast and slow. System one. Seemed to be, it was one of the first ones. Gee, unconscious.
Yeah, when we're talking about cognitive biases, it isn't a good question to ask, is it good or bad, positive or negative? It just is. It's a byproduct of how our brains process information. Sure. And until we evolve, right, to develop new biases, we're subject to the negative impact of those biases.
Yeah, screen there, Matthew. It had to do with, wait a minute. No, that wasn't it. It was one of the first ones, and I may have read it wrong, but it seemed to implicate, or imply, I should say, that, you know, bias in itself is negative, which is not what you're saying. I should have written some of those. Anyway, forget it. There are people who have better focused questions than the one I'm trying to put up. So anyway, thanks for joining us. I really appreciate it.
Bill, no worries. You're giving me a great segue right into one of the questions I'd like to leave you with, right? So this again, just to recap, the bias ecosystem, bias is born in our thoughts, manifests itself through our behaviors, gets baked into our systems and institutions. Now, as bias evolves in our bias ecosystem, if it's doing damage in an individual action, if that individual action is perpetuated over and over and over and over and over again, then it's going to do more damage when it gets baked into a system, right? So I don't want to leave you with the impression that just bias is one or the other, right? I think that's also a cognitive quirk, is that our memory is very, very, very fallible. And we are predictably irrational. If you haven't read a book, I'll give another shout out to Dan Ariely. Dan Ariely wrote many, many, many books, but one of his groundbreaking books was Predictably Irrational. And it's shining some light on these cognitive quirks and how they can create different, you know, they manifest themselves into our reality in different ways. And historically, they manifested themselves into our reality in very negative ways. And now we're looking to shift and change, right? The landscape that we find ourselves in the workplace is fundamentally different than it was 20 years ago, 10 years ago, 5 years ago. It's evolving, it's changing, right? We may not like it, but it doesn't mean it's bad. So let me stop sharing again. And then I have a couple more slides that I'll break down, you know, oversimplified suggestions for mitigation strategies and unintended consequences. And I can run through those before we run out of time, but I want to make sure the questions get brought into this context before I focus on what I thought was most important.
Thank you. Thank you. A terrific presentation. I do a daily Monday through Friday show on Clubhouse relating to pitching, helping people with their investor pitch or customer pitch. And you just gave me some deep thoughts here. The idea is that if you have any experience in sales whatsoever, your job is to address biases and understanding what a bias is from a customer, from people who you're trying to get to take action. If you don't understand what biases are, how do you overcome them? Which is kind of leading to many people's objections that you need to overcome as a salesperson. And the idea is that if you look at biases as punitive in a corporate setting versus potentially strategic from a marketing sales position, right? There's a way to look at biases. Almost anything that a corporation forces you to do is going to be looked at as negative, or some institutional requirement will be looked at as negative. From my perspective, when I'm training people on sales and pitching and presentations and what have you, biases are your advantage. Understanding the biases that you have or customers have helps you to create a differentiation of yourself, helps you to improve your potential engagement with folks. And so the question for you is, number one, I'd love to have you on my program because what you offer is terrific and vital for founders and business people to know about biases. And number two is, how do you switch the idea as far as the take action part of this? Because what Alan says, I think there's a lot of people that hold that concept together here, and I can even see how that makes a lot of sense. Question is, how do you get people to look at those biases in a way to create advancement? In some cases, I think what you're saying is some of those biases cause harm, and those are the ones that you want to address. But how do you get people to take action regarding biases? Because sometimes these presentations, they go on, and nothing happens except we had this conversation, everybody gets upset. How do you create meaningful change as a result of what you're doing with folks and corporations, what have you? Thank you so much.
That's awesome. Thank you. I don't know your name other than what it says. So thank you, Pitch Freak. I appreciate the questions, and I thank you for working with salespeople to make them better. When I work with salespeople and I apply this framework with a group of salespeople, I'm really going against a lot of institutionalized biases that salespeople themselves have, right? Like salespeople, if we did a list or just put into the chat, anybody willing, give me a stereotype of salespeople, right? And everybody still has that lingering sense of sleazy car salesman, selfish, only out for what they want, blah, 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 blah. And sales is so fundamentally different now, right? That the more a person would try to embody any one of those stereotypes, is they're just going to go down a rat hole and never be successful. They're not going to get any kind of sales, right? And so it's really, you have to rewrite some pretty deep-seated scripts that people have about sales and how to engage with people and how to interact with people, right? And it's much more question-driven than it is, you know, trying to impress somebody with your vast degree of knowledge. So those are some comments that I have about bias as it comes, as it relates to sales. I think salespeople are, you know, they're missing so much money. If they don't even go through the five common cognitive biases and understand how those biases and reflect on those and how they've impacted their decisions, right? I have no shortage of stories of people who, you know, of men who have realized they always focused on the man in a relationship when a couple is going to buy a home, for example. And, you know, easy example of like me bias. I have other examples of salespeople who just left money on the table because they thought it needed to go a certain way and they really didn't pause and open themselves up to other possibilities. And a lot of proximity bias. That's one we didn't even talk about yet. Proximity bias, how we overvalue that which is closest to us by time and space. And now we live in a virtual world where your best, you know, sales partner, your next great client could be 3,000 miles away, right? But you've only had interactions with them through this medium. So proximity bias is something that we really need to put some mitigation strategies around, or else we're going to be, you know, subject to the, you know, the negative consequence of it.
Great. Thank you so much, Matthew. That's been a great presentation. I know everybody here loves this talk, and you know, we want to thank you for joining us today. That was amazing.